You have your Bibles, like where you turn with me to Psalms, the 119th chapter. Psalms, the 119th chapter. I believe, just as a matter of fact, this is the longest chapter in the Bible. So after we've read that, it'll be past lunchtime. I think it also it might contain somewhere around the center of the Bible in its whole, if I'm not mistaken, somewhere right around here. For a few weeks, we have been talking about the Word of God, and I don't think that there's a more appropriate topic to entertain in the church than the Word of God. Amen? Amen. Having said that, when we talk about the Word of God, most people just look and they say, well, you're talking about the Bible. And true that the Bible, is the Word of God. Amen. Amen. However, the print is finite, which means you can read all the print. You can read the Bible. There are people here that have read the Bible. We know what it says, but the depth is infinite. The spirit behind the text is infinite. The Bible says in John 1:1 that the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And of course that would be Jesus. So when we talk about the Word of God, we're not only talking about the Bible. We entertained all the scriptures over the past couple of weeks that said the Word of the Lord came to so-and-so. One was Abraham. It says, in a vision or in a dream. And I know that some of you have had dreams that you thought were of a spiritual nature. And I have too. And sometimes we're correct in saying that. The Bible is full of instances where people have had visions and have had dreams and confirmations of what the Spirit of the Lord was saying to them. Most oftentimes it's through the text. The printed word. You can count on that. And I wanted to look at how that this chapter anchored our faith in the Word of God. Amen? And I think all of us want to be, and the reason we're here is we want to be right with God. Amen? Amen? I don't think there's a soul in here that doesn't want to be right with God. Well, I'll say this. You can't be right with God and wrong with the Word. Now, I know that is not a popular message, but I don't stand up here to deliver popular messages or what is chic or to make you comfortable in your sin, but to let you know that there is a way to be forgiven. There is a way of life that's pleasing to God, and there's a way of life that's not pleasing to God. And some of that, it's never changed. Some people like to root out scriptures in the Old Testament as if they don't matter anymore. However, there's some things that God still doesn't like, and there's some things that He does like. Like, He enjoys the humility of an individual, and He doesn't like pride. He doesn't like a haughty look or someone that thinks they've got it all together even when they don't, or they present themselves in a false manner, presenting themselves to the world that they do have it all together when inside they're broken and hurting and just like a lot of people. It's a falseness that the Lord doesn't like. He doesn't like a lying tongue. There is one, I think, proverb that says something like, six things does the Lord hate, and yea, seven are abominations to Him. Hey, you know what? I don't like to camp out on things that are an abomination to God, because that's not where the majority of us are. And so what I'm speaking to you is having a relationship with the Word of God that is healthy, knowing the voice of the shepherd. We can't believe the Scripture or what Jesus said if we don't believe that the shepherd still speaks to his sheep. Amen. Jesus is not going to say, my sheep know my voice and another they will not follow, and then not speak to his sheep. Amen. Now, The majority of the times he does that through the Word, and I've shared over the last couple of weeks how the Lord has used his Word in my life to uphold me. One of the songs that we sang this morning, actually the majority of the songs that we sang this morning are scripturally based, and what I mean by that is this last song, Thou, O Lord, art a shield about me. You're the glory and the lifter of my head. That's a scripture. That's not just a song. And many of the songs, like the one about healing, the Bible says in Isaiah that Jesus would be bruised for our iniquities, or the chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. That's a scripture. The reason that we sing about that is because we believe the Word of God. Amen. And so when the Word of God comes to you, when you read the Word of God, you've got to believe the Word of God. And of course, we have context, and a lot of times we need good counsel and people to help us through some of the harder text or some of the things of the Bible that's harder to understand, like why do bad things happen to good people, or why do wicked people seem to prosper? That's an age-old question. As a matter of fact, David asked the same questions in the song. Why do the wicked prosper? I don't want you to go there, but one time, David cried out to the Lord that the Lord would break out the teeth of his enemy, you know? It sounds reasonable, amen. You get into a pinch and you cry out to the Lord, and you say, well, what was the result of that? He was able to sling a stone straight, and his enemy fell before him. And so was it before or after that that he wrote and penned those words? I don't know, but he knew that God was able, amen. He trusted the Word of God. And so I wanted to read a few of these and basically give you a pattern of trusting in the Word of God and some reasons that we do. A lot of people dismiss the Bible as just historical or old, written by men. I've heard that one. That's a good one. I'll tell you, it's the most beautiful quilt I've ever seen knit together. Amen. 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 You talk about a comforter. Amen. Amen. The Word of God is precious. It's tried and true. This chapter, you would do well to read it in its entirety, that you'll see exactly what I'm sharing this morning. Now, I'm not going to put up every scripture on the screen, but I do have the reference verses here. The first one that I would like to go to is Psalms 119 and 9. It says, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto according to thy word. When you hear that phrase, and that's what I've focused in on, thy word, it's talking about the Word of God, the Word that's come from heaven. How can a man cleanse his way? And the way is to take heed to the Word of God. Take heed to the Word of God. Take heed to what God has said. And so I think that's more than reasonable. If you track this study down through the text, you'll see that phrase also, according to thy word. Some people would look to heaven and pray to God and say, be it unto me according to thy word. I think even Mary said the same thing when she was told she was going to have a baby. She said, be it unto me according to thy word. That's what I want you to focus in on this morning. That's what I want all minds to be focused in on, thy word. Thy word. You see, we're talking about the Word of God. Some of the scriptures that we use and that we revere and some of the prophetic utterances that we have, they come after David wrote what he wrote in this psalm. And some of the words that we have and some of the feelings that we get and some of the prophetic utterances come through David himself. David would be moved by the Spirit of God. God would speak to him things that would happen hundreds of years later, and he would pin them down, and we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that he heard from the Lord, because what he said came to pass. David, before Christ was ever crucified, before Christ was ever born in the manger, he said things like, "Dogs have compassed me about. They pierced my hands and my feet." Before the Romans even came on the scene. Before crucifixion in that manner was an element of punishment, or the manner that they did that, David was moved upon to say these things by the Spirit of God. He heard the Word, and he pinned them down. And now they're precious, and we revere them, and we know them as true. How can a person get right? By doing things according to the Word of God. You say, I've been on this kick for a few weeks, as you know. There's a headline that I read a week or so ago that said, it was talking about an errant minister, and the quote of the article, or the headline of the article said, "An angel of reason visited me and told me that the Bible was wrong." Not so. You can write it in print and you can put that impression that the Bible's wrong. The Bible's not wrong. And the Word of God is not wrong. Things that are wrong, they're still wrong. Malachi, God says, "I am the Lord thy God, I change not." And so there was a merciful element to God, and God, even in the New Testament, speaking through the writers, said things like, in regards to the Pharaoh, which is as deep back in the Old Testament as you can get, and you can know how God used him in the plight of the children of Israel. God said, "I will have mercy upon whom I will have mercy." And so we can see interwoven through the whole text, the Word of God. And you think about it like this. He said, "Let there be light." Everything that we see is because of Jesus Christ. Nothing that was created without Him. And that's a beautiful part of the text that we enjoy as truth. Through these verses of Scripture, if you follow along with me, there are many that reinforce the Word of God in this passage of Scripture. And it helps you to understand the dynamics of what the Word can actually do in you. The Word can strengthen you in the 28th verse. The 38th verse, you can be established in it. The 41st verse says that mercy and salvation comes from thy Word. It's trustworthy in the 42nd verse. You can be quickened or made alive in the 50th verse. You can be kept by the Word. You can hope in the Word. You can be comforted in the 76th verse by the Word. And in the 89th verse, thy Word is settled. Amen. That means there's no debate. It's over. Thy Word is settled. And we can take heart in that. I want to put up the 105th verse. Here is another that, as a young man, how many would like to learn a verse of Scripture before you leave here today? Amen. You may already know it. Here it is. Forget the first part there, that N-U-N. But thy Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. That's a beautiful scripture, isn't it? Amen. How many have you ever heard somebody say, I need to know God's will for my life? Let me tell you a good place to start. Amen. The Word. Right? I'm gonna start reading the Bible. I can't tell you how many people have come to church and they're unfamiliar with the text, and it's kind of like floundering. They're floundering. They have all these ideals that the world has put on them that don't really jive with the Word of God. But when they start reading the Word of God, they begin to see things more clearly. Their path is illuminated. Revelation comes from heaven to the Word, and it leaps off the page. No longer is it just a novel or a written text, but it's the Word of God. And it comes alive, and something happens when creation, us, when we, the created, began to have a relationship with the Creator through the Word of God. You begin to allow that to percolate into your life, and you begin to function in the dynamics of what it means to be according to the Word of the Lord. Be it unto me as according to the Word of the Lord. So every good thing that the Scripture places on His faithful, then you can too reach out and grab that as a promise. I want to try this. I learned this Scripture as a child. Many Scriptures I learned as a child, and I didn't heed them very well. My teenage years got away, the path got very dark, because I went divergent from what God would have had me do. And my life was a mess. I was off track, off the path, far from the path. But I learned the Scripture when I was very young through a song. You know, most of the songs are designed to be sang, or that designed to be musical, and I wish we had the notes of everyone, but this one was one that as a child I learned to sing, and it embedded it in the depths of my soul. I can't tell you, you know, I was raised right up until, well, I was raised right as a child, and we sang all the church songs, and I didn't realize how deeply that they had impacted me until I came back to church years later, and the songs were still there. The songs were still there. I'm talking deep blue book songs. I'm talking page numbers and verses that some people don't know. Every once in a while on Facebook, I'll start off an old hymn with just the first few words, and there are people still left that know the rest of those songs. Victory today is mine. Amen. Amen. I used to use the Blue Book a lot when I preached because I love those songs so much. But this psalm, it says, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." If we could this morning embrace that truth, we would do well. Amen. Amen. Thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my path. Have you ever heard something like that?
I have not.
Thy word. How about this, guys? I want you to have a little bass ring out for me. This is, it's very simple. Okay, this is not like extracurricular or anything. It's two words. Okay, and what I want you to do is I want you to sing this for me. All right, two words. Can you? Are you with me, Jay? Are you with me? Okay. All right. It says, I'll give you a hint. It says, "Thy word." Okay, that's all I said. So it'll be very simple. Thy word. Let's do it. One. Thy word. Ladies, I want you to come in with the second part, okay? It's a little bit more complex, but you're complex creatures. Amen. And you're better singers for the most part. Thy word. It's a lamp unto my feet. Okay? That's what I want. I'm going to have the guys start off again, and then ladies, I want you to chime in. It is a lamp unto my feet, okay? Thy word
is a
little slow there. Hold on now. Hold on.
You gave that how to sing.
That was pretty bad.
Let me give you an example. Thy word.
is a lamp unto my feet, is a lamp unto my feet.
Oh, can you do that? Okay. Guys, on count three. One, two, three.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet,
and a light unto my path.
How about that? We'll all do the last part, okay? Okay, guys, on the count three. One, two, three.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet,
and a light unto my path.
You know what scripture now. Amen. Just like we sang a little earlier, Thou, O Lord, art a shield about me. You're the glory and the lifter of my head. When people go around and their chin's down and they're depressed and they're discouraged, the Word of God reaches down through the Spirit and takes hold of their chin and says, I don't want you looking down. You can look up.
Amen.
You can look up. Because the Word of God is true, and it's powerful, and it's sharp, and it penetrates the depth of who we are, and it hits to the core of what's going on in our life. And now I want you to understand that that same Word can be a lamp unto every step you take. And you know, the Bible says that in the mouth of two or three witnesses, a matter is established. And if you have any doubt about the validity of this Word, there are other scriptures that will go right along with it. And it says, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. There's a reason that you're here this morning. There's a reason that you've met the people that you've met. There's a reason that you've come into the house of the Lord this morning. And it's because the Lord desires you to come closer to Him in a right relationship with Him through His Word. Through Jesus. Through His Word. A lot of people are scared of that. A lot of people see the Bible as something they can never attain the goodness of all that's contained in the Bible. But I'm going to ask you a very good question. How many marriages do you think have had faithfulness in them? Amen. Now listen, now I'm telling you, there are some marriages that have faithfulness as an element in the relationship. Right?
Amen.
Amen. It better be that way.
Amen.
Right? That's the way it's designed. Right? Okay. Well, that's the way God designed you to be in relationship with Him. As a matter of fact, He described it that way. Many times we miss the scripture because of the way that we use it sometimes. I can't tell you how many weddings that I've done and I've used the scripture that talks about how that Christ loved the church. Just like a husband loves his bride and gave himself for it. That means for you. He gave himself for you. The same type of faithfulness that applies to a marriage and the same type of faithfulness that a husband expects from a wife and a wife expects from a husband, the same type of faithfulness is what God expects from you in a relationship. Now, how many ladies would enter into a marriage with a man that said, I love you, but I can't be faithful? No. You just wouldn't have it. You wouldn't have it. But somehow or another, we imagine God is somehow different. It's heavy, right?
Yeah.
It's heavy. I know. The Bible, though, it's kind of fluid because of the Spirit. There is a waves of truth that will sweep over you. The Bible talks about seasons of refreshing that come from the Lord, and the Spirit moves in certain ways, and when it does, our lives are convicted about the way that we were, and we reach out to heaven knowing that God is a forgiving God from His Word, and that He will accept you if you will humble yourselves, and if you'll turn to Him, He'll give you clarity. He'll order your steps. He'll be faithful to you. He's not going to let you down. He's not going to disappoint you. I'll tell you what, I've disappointed the Lord many times.
but he's never disappointed me.
Amen.
He gives me a supreme example of faithfulness, self-sacrifice, selflessness, humility. In our Wednesday night Bible study, we've been in the part of John that says that he got up from supper and he took a towel and a basin of water and he humbled himself as a servant, as the King of all glory. He washed the disciples' feet and he said, as I've done this to you, so ought ye to do to one another. And in that we see the supreme example of servitude and humility, and it works.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. The Bible, the Word of God, the Spirit of God, it works. It works to be able to cleanse you from unrighteousness. It works to be able to lift you out of despair, to pick you up and wash you off. The blood of Christ, the Word of God, it's able to do exceedingly abundantly above what we can even imagine. And I can imagine a very faithful God. He's more. As we look at the remainder of Psalms 119, it goes on and it says, Thy word is pure. It's worthy of meditation. It's true. One that I saw, I think it's the 61st, it has the word awe. And of course, that's awesome. Thy word is awesome. It brings understanding in the 169th verse. In the 170th verse, it brings deliverance. Because when the Lord says something, amen. There's a scripture that says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. We have that liberty here because we love the Lord and we love one another. And there's no fear in love. Perfect love casts out fear. And we want to be found in Him and Him in us. Because the Bible says that if you abide in me and my word abides in you, then you can ask what you will and it shall be done. I've had a good thought. You've heard it said, I want my name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Well, here, my friends, you have what I'll call the Lamb's Book of Life. And I have a very pointed question. Do you find your name in this book, in the middle of this word? Is this word in you? And are you in this word? That's a good question, right? And you say, well, Brother Scott, how can I be in this word? Well, are you honest? Are you virtuous? Are you humble? If so, then in the middle of humility and in the middle of temperance, in the middle of patience, in the middle of virtue, can you be found in the middle of those descriptives? Or are you outside the word? And all that's over here, humility's over here, and servitude is over here, and love is over here, and on this side is hatred or variance or any of the works that are listed. And that's where you are, and that's what's in you. And I'll tell you, if that's where you are, I think that you need to take a step of faith and venture over into what Christ would have you be. What you were really designed to be was a part of God's Word.
Amen.
You were created by Him. Nothing that was created. David said in one verse, he said, I was fearfully and wonderfully made. Talking about before He was ever born, He was knit together in the womb. Mm-hmm. So were you. You are not here by any other virtue than by the virtue that Christ is the creator of all things. And He created you for a specific purpose, and the world pressures us to attempt to make us something different than what we were designed to be. And so I come to you that your life would be according to the Word of God. Luke, the 5th chapter and the 5th verse, I believe. There's a time when the disciples were being called and things weren't quite working out in the way that they were living their life. And I think they had toiled all night fishing, looking to catch something. And I can identify with that. Jesus appears and he says, let down your nets on the right side, you know. And they say something that's very pointed. They say, we've toiled all night. And I want to tell you, the way you've been doing life may have got you this far. But there may be a step of faith that you need to take. And this is what his disciples said. They said, we've toiled all night. And that might be what you're saying. Lord, I've worked at this for a long time. Life is getting old. But they said, nevertheless, at thy word. And when they let down their nets, they caught so many fish, they couldn't even hardly bring them in. And that's what I want for you and your life and your family and your generations. Is I want a life that's pleasing to God and that will be passed on as faith that is worth having. And that faith is in the word of the Lord. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Would you stand with me this morning? I want to thank you for your time. Our altar is always open. But I want to close with a word of prayer this morning that the Lord would be glorified in our lives. And if you would, bow your head and just let the Lord bless you. Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you for your word. And Lord, as seeds that are cast on fertile ground, I ask for every morsel, every piece of this bread of life that would find a home in the hearts and the minds of everybody that's here this morning, that they would be able to share that your word is able to be a light unto their path and a lamp unto their feet, Lord. I just ask that you would solidify your word in their lives and bring it to pass according to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Shake somebody's hand. Let them know that you love them this morning. We appreciate you being here.